Welcome to the next chapter in grid-connected PV systems, in which we will look at the different components of a PV system. In this unit, I will provide an overview of the different types of PV systems. We have now learned about the two main components of a PV system, the PV modules themselves and the inverter. For a complete PV system, however, a number of other components are needed. Which components these actually are depends very much on the type of the specific system. Basically, PV systems can be divided into two main groups: standalone systems, which are operated independently of the power grid, and grid-connected systems, which can feed electricity into the public power grid. First of all, let's take a look at an off-grid system. The simplest form of such a standalone PV system is a directly coupled system, where the DC output of a PV module or array is directly connected to a DC load. However, the load in this system can only operate when the sun is shining and the PV modules are generating power. If it is also to be operated at night or during periods of low irradiation, a battery storage must also be integrated into the system. In addition, a charge controller that protects the battery storage from deep or overcharging is needed. If you want to operate AC consumers with this standalone system, you also need an inverter. In a special battery inverter, the functions of the charge controller are often already integrated. The system setup shown here is typical for systems on buildings whose power supply is completely independent of the public grid. In this case, the battery storage must of course be large enough to ensure power consumption at night or for several days with low irradiation. Worldwide, however, only a small proportion of PV modules are installed in standalone systems. So let's have a look at grid-connected systems. Here you can see the typical system structure of a large PV system in the megawatt range, which can be found in ground-mounted systems. Depending on the inverter concept used, several strings of the PV generator are connected in parallel here. For this purpose, the string lines or string cables are first brought together in the so-called generator connection or junction box. The junction box can contain various components for protecting the system. For example, blocking diodes, string fuses, or components that protect against overvoltages caused by lightning. From the generator connection box, the string currents are then carried together in the main DC main line to the inverter, from where they are fed into the public grid. The DC main line has a significantly higher cross section than the string lines. The current fed into the grid is counted by a feed-in meter. Furthermore, there is a large and steadily growing number of rooftop installations worldwide that are connected to the public grid. You can see here a typical grid-connected PV system, as it can be found on many million roofs around the world. In such a system, the PV modules are typically installed on the roof using a special mounting system and are connected in one or more strings, depending on the generator size and orientation of the modules. A generator connection box is only used in some of the installations. Often the strings are connected directly to the inverter via the string lines. From here, the PV electricity can be used to supply the consumers in the house. If the electricity cannot be completely consumed by the home, it can also be fed into the public grid. In many countries, system owners receive a feed-in tariff for this. Of course, the opposite can also happen. More electricity is needed than is currently being generated. In this case, additional electricity is drawn from the public grid. In order to measure the electricity fed into the grid, as well as the electricity drawn, an import and an export meter are installed at the distribution panel. If a bidirectional meter is used, then only 1 meter is necessary. In addition, nowadays, a PV production meter is often installed behind the inverter, which counts the total electricity generated by the PV system. This allows us to determine the self-consumption of the PV electricity. The self-consumption is calculated by dividing the self-consumed solar energy by the total electricity consumption in kilowatt hours. The self-consumed solar energy results from the difference between total yield of the PV system, which is measured by meter 7, and the feed-in, which is measured by meter 6. The total electricity consumption is again calculated from the self-consumed solar energy plus the electricity purchased, which is also measured by meter 6. But why is determining self-consumption important at all? To understand why self-consumption of solar power is of interest in the first place, let's take a look at the political regulations governing the subsidization of PV system. Let's take Germany as an example. Germany was one of the first countries to introduce a feed-in tariff for solar power in 2000. Initially, the feed-in tariff was almost 51 cents per kilowatt hour. At the same time, the electricity purchase price was only 15 euro cents per kilowatt hour. At that time, it would not have been worthwhile to consume the generated electricity oneself. Therefore, almost all plants in Germany were built according to the principle of full feed-in. All the PV electricity generated was fed into the public grid, while all the electricity demand was met by drawing from the public grid. However, as the number of PV installations increased and the cost of components decreased, the feed-in tariff was gradually reduced. For example, the feed-in tariff for a system built in 2022 is now only a maximum of 6.8 euro cents per kilowatt hour, while the electricity purchase price has risen to over 30 euro cents per kilowatt hour. In Germany, it is therefore becoming increasingly interesting for plant operators to consume as much PV electricity as possible themselves. For this reason, today the majority of PV systems in Germany are operated somewhat different. Only the part of the electricity that cannot be consumed by the household itself is fed into the grid. The same applies to many other countries where there is either no feed-in tariff at all, or the tariff is significantly lower than the electricity purchase price. The question for plant operators is therefore how they can maximize their self-consumption as far as possible. Let's take a look at this using an example. Here you can see a typical daily pattern of the electricity consumption of a household. There are clear electricity peaks in the morning and midday hours. However, most of the consumption occurs in the evening hours. If a PV system is now installed, part of the electricity demand can be covered by the PV electricity. The surplus part of the electricity is fed into the grid. However, in the morning and in the evening hours, no PV electricity is available, and electricity must be drawn from the grid. This is where an idea comes in that is being implemented in more and more newly built PV systems. Instead of feeding the surplus electricity into the grid during the sunny midday hours, it is temporarily stored in a battery storage system. In the evening, or when the sun is not shining and the production of solar power decreases, the electricity demand can be covered by the storage. There are various ways in which a battery storage system can be integrated into the PV system. In each case, you need the storage itself and an additional component that controls the charging and discharging of the battery. Showing here is a PV system with a battery inverter that converts the direct current of the battery into alternating current, similar to a solar inverter, and feeds it into the household grid. This is referred to as AC coupling. However, there are also other systems in which the battery is connected to the PV generator on the DC side via a charge controller. This configuration would be called DC coupling. We have now become familiar with a whole range of components that are required in addition to the PV modules for a complete functioning PV system. In addition to the inverter, cables, electricity meters, and possibly a battery and a charge controller, the mounting system for the PV modules should also be mentioned here. All these components are also called balance of system, or BOS. In this chapter, we will deal with these system components in more detail. Let us summarize. PV systems can basically be divided into standalone PV systems and grid-connected PV systems. Battery storage systems can be integrated into all types of systems. The inverter, the cables, the mounting system, the battery, and all other system components represent the balance of system. Thank you for your attention.